invited to come and be a part of it. It is a biblical study in which he will be leading us into what the Bible teaches. In case you don't know me, I'm Dale Benavale. I am a former sinner saved by the grace of Jesus Christ. I'm a former pastor saved by the grace of Jesus Christ. I am a mental health therapist saved by the grace of Christ. All of that by the grace of Christ. Would you turn your Bibles, please, to Ephesians, the second chapter? We're going to read my two favorite scriptures in the Bible. These are my choice scriptures. I don't know if you have preferences, but I like these best of all. Ephesians, the second chapter, comes after Galatians. Galatians, Ephesians. Ephesians, the second chapter. Ephesians, the second chapter, the eighth verse. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. That is key to everything we preach. There are religions of every kind of description that talk about different kinds of actions and works that you have to do in order to be accepted into their future life. All kinds of acts and works. Some actually blow people up as an effort to get there. Others have rules and regs that are required of them as they enter the inner sanctum of their religion. But the Bible teaches that Jesus came to say, the fulfillment of the law is this: you're saved by grace. Grace, a Greek word, the grace that we find in the scripture says that it is unmerited mercy, kodis, unmerited mercy. In other words, you didn't work for it, you didn't earn it. Now, I'm going to come to your house, I'm going to knock on your door, and I'm going to be driving a Mercedes-Benz. And I'm going to say to you, this is your Mercedes-Benz. Would anybody refuse it? What's the matter, you boy? How about a Rolls Royce?
What a nice pickup.
Just stay out of my sermon, all right? And you people with tomatoes, keep them to yourself. I bring a... And I say, this is a gift for you. Oh, is this great? All right, now you need to give me $100,000. When did it cease being a gift? Anytime you have to pay for something, it is not a gift. Or if I said, if you'll work for the rest of your life digging out sewers, you can have it. Again. That is not a gift. You see, grace is unmerited. It is not something we can earn, work for, pay for. We can't go to church enough to get it. We can't read the Bible enough to get it. My wife actually reads through the Bible from Genesis to Revelation every year. She hates Revelation. But she's loving this study on Wednesday night. I'm really shocked. Reads through the entire Bible every single year. Usually looks for a different translation or Bible that she can use in her reading. But that's not going to get her into heaven. Reading through the Bible doesn't get us there. The Bible says it is by grace. If I try to do anything to earn my salvation, it's worthless. Then why do we do anything good? To say thank you to God for what He has done for us. We want, it's like writing at the bottom, thank you, Lord. I want to serve you and do what you want. Let me tell you about some people, because I'm not very deep theologically. I want to tell you about some folks that have had some experiences. Jesus, when He was walking the earth, He ran across this fisherman by the name of Simon, and He said to Simon, hey, come follow Me. And for 3 years, Simon listened and watched and participated in the miracles of Jesus as Jesus performed these miracles in front of him. And he found out what grace was all about. And Jesus called him Peter, the Rock. Now the Rock would later on deny he even knew Jesus at the crucifixion, but that didn't ruin Simon. Remember grace? Because God's grace still reached out to Peter. And he became a great preacher in the kingdom of God. There was this guy, Saul, who was looking everywhere to kill Christians. And he was successful. And then God reached out to him and extended grace. And he's the guy that wrote this letter. He says, it wasn't all that stuff I did in my religion that got me saved. It's the grace of Jesus. There's a guy, Matthew, who was a rich guy. You know, God actually reaches out to rich people. It's not just poor folks. And this rich guy, and Jesus said, hey, follow me. And the rich guy says, hey, all right. And he followed Jesus. Wrote a gospel that we read called Matthew. I knew a lawyer that was crooked. Some of you say, yeah. I knew a lawyer who was crooked. I'm not talking ordinary crooked. I'm talking about Cosa Nostra crooked. I'm talking about organized crime crooked. I'm talking about planning crimes with the criminals and then getting them off and guaranteeing that they wouldn't do time in prison. And he made sure that happened through hook or crook. But he himself got caught and sent to prison. And on a filthy floor in that prison, he threw himself before a God he did not believe in. And he said, God, have mercy on me. And God reached out, and in 2 years and 13 days, he walked free from a 50-year sentence, and he now runs a prison ministry. You can actually Google it and find out about it. There's a man by the name of John Newton. John Newton was a guy who was a captain of a ship. That ship, back in the 1700s, hauled slaves. I want to tell you about that. It's hard for us to comprehend something when we haven't actually experienced it, but we could sort of get a picture of people traveling for weeks on end inside a confine that's about 3 to 3.5 feet high, stacked together, many of them men, women, and children dying while they made the trip because they were not given anything. They had no resources. It was just a matter of survival until they got to a land where they would then be sold into slavery. This man piloted one of those ships in carrying those people across the waves. But one day in the midst of a storm, he found grace. Christ reached out and radically changed him. In fact, he wrote a song, and we know it.
I recorded that song the way I hear it. When I sing it, I still hear the sounds of the slave ships in the water. I want to sing it for you the way John Newton probably first heard it, coming up out of the belly of the ship. Listen. Mm-hmm.
moves me. A man who hauled slaves in horrendous condition met up with God, and through the grace of Christ, his life was radically changed. He would later, he came to know Christ in 1748. He would later become a minister of the gospel because he wanted to tell other people about what Christ can do. There was a young man, a teenager, who was driving a car with a couple of guys, and the guys went into a store and robbed it and killed someone. They came running out. He didn't know about it, but they said, "Hey, drive! We just shot somebody." And he foolishly drove. He ended up getting caught. The two who did the murder turned on him, and he got sent to prison. But in prison, he came face to face with Jesus, and Christ saved him. And he experienced the grace of Christ. And Christ moved into his life. Eventually, he would be pardoned. And he wrote a book called Twice Pardoned. The governor pardoned him, but most importantly, Christ himself pardoned him. He didn't earn it, but he got the pardon. There was a guy a number of decades ago by the name of Nicky Cruz. He was a gang leader, violent New York City street gangs. He was involved in criminal behaviors and violence and pain for others. But he met Jesus, and the grace of Christ changed him. Some of you are old enough to remember a guy by the name of David Berkowitz. He was called the Son of Sam. Anybody here remember that? David Berkowitz, Son of Sam. He committed at least 6 murders and injured many others besides the ones that he murdered. And he writes this testimony, and I do hate to do it, but I want you to hear his testimony. After a very few messed up early life, eventually I crossed that invisible line of no return. After years of mental torment, behavior problems, deep inner struggles, my own rebellious ways, I became the criminal that at the time it seemed as if it was my destiny to become. Looking back, it was all a horrible nightmare, and I would do anything if I could undo everything that happened. 6 people lost their lives. Many others suffered at my hand and will continue to suffer for a lifetime. I am so sorry for that. In 78, I was sentenced to about 365 consecutive years, virtually burying me alive behind prison walls. When I first entered the prison system, I was placed in isolation. I was then sent to a psychiatric hospital because I was declared temporarily insane. Eventually, I was sent to other prisons, including the infamous Attica. As with many inmates, life in prison is a struggle. I've had my share of problems, hassles, fights. At one time, I almost lost my life when another inmate cut my throat. Yet all through this, and I did not realize it until later, God had his loving hands on me. A fellow inmate shared Jesus with me. It was at that moment in 1987 that I began to pour out my heart to God. Everything seemed to hit me at once. The guilt from what I did, the disgust at what I'd become. Late that night in my cold cell, I got down on my knees and began to cry out to Jesus Christ. I told him that I was sick and tired of doing evil. I asked Jesus to forgive me for all my sins. I spent a good while on my knees praying to him. When I got up, it felt as if a very heavy but invisible chain had been around me for so many years was broken. A peace flooded over me. I did not understand what was happening, but in my heart I just knew that my life somehow was going to be different. And in point of fact, he has a prison ministry that he continues to reach out to others from there. That is the grace of Christ. He did not deserve it, but Jesus reached out to him. My father ran moonshine. He was violent. He was actually seeking someone to kill when he came face to face with Jesus walking down the street. Not a visible Jesus, but the Spirit of Jesus speaking to his heart. His life was radically changed, and he came to know Jesus in a real way because of God's grace. And because of that, God called him to preach. And he had a faithful ministry in the kingdom of God. But people do not have to be criminals, killers, moonshiners, atheists to need Christ. Kirk Cameron, some of you may recognize that name, an actor. And many others. But Kirk Cameron had everything most people want: fame, money, looks, success. None of that compared to the joy he later found in knowing Christ and being forgiven. You see, people can have it all on this earth and be missing the most important thing on the planet, and that is a relationship with Jesus. Does the grace of Christ cover people who have come to the right relationship with Christ but yet fall away? Well, ask Peter. Peter would stand and deny the one he had walked with for three years. He had seen perform miracles. He would deny him with an oath. And yet the grace of Christ would reach out to him. James tells us that we are to reach out to those who have strayed to draw them back to that grace. Was Jesus' sacrifice enough? Well, if you know anything about the crucifixion, you know that Jesus was horribly abused in the crucifixion. We have the Son of God whose back was laid open because of the blows that he received. He was struck on the face multiple times. He was spat upon. This is the Son of God. And he was nailed to a cross. And his last word was tetelestai. He uttered one last word, tetelestai. That word's in John 19:30. Tetelestai. And I can't imagine really what it was like for his mother to stand below that cross and to hear him say that word, tetelestai. But the word means paid in full. Paid in full. He used a financial word to say the debt is paid, and then he gave up his soul to eternity. Then he went on. He paid the price that you and I can't pay. All of us together couldn't pay it. We couldn't rectify one single sin in our lives. But Jesus paid for it all. Paid in full. We cannot add anything to what Jesus did to save ourselves.
Eyes. Oh, the temple veil
between two ways. Some still choose to mock his name. His followers, as they can boldly say, we are the reason that he came. See the ones who trust themselves alone to do what only Christ can do. Through Jesus' blood alone, we may approach the Father's throne. In his words, he still calls to you. So much from this. My wife's not here, is she? Oh. But I want to share with you a short passage from a recent day of reading. And she wrote, "But so you may know that the Son of God has authority on earth to forgive sins," he told the paralyzed man, "I tell you, get up, pick up your stretcher, and go home." Beth wrote, "I can remember so being so devastated over a sin I had allowed to ensnare me that I repeatedly begged God to forgive me. I confessed my sin with great sorrow and turned radically from it. Still, I continued to plead for forgiveness. Then one day in my Bible reading, God revealed these scriptures to me from Luke 5. He spoke to my heart and he said, "Beth, my child, you have an authority problem. You think you can do your part, which is repent, but you just don't think I can do my part, which is forgiving." Some of us here live a daily life of begging for forgiveness for past foolishness and sin when Jesus has forgiven us. And we still live in the past. We still live in regret. And we haven't trusted Him that He truly has forgiven us. And that's an important point for we who are believers to know. That when we come to Him and we say, "Father, I blew it. Please forgive me." He does. He really does. Then it's up to us to forgive ourselves. And to recognize that we learn from that foolishness and we go on with our lives. And then we continue the track with Jesus. And say to Him, "I'm going to do everything I can to be your man or woman. I'm going to do everything I can to be what you want me to be." Christ paid for me and my failures. And He'll pay for yours too. Whatever those are. And I know it's tedious for you, but this song is my testimony. forgiveness today? Do you need Christ to forgive you? He will. He went through torture to make sure you know He will forgive you. Do you need to forgive yourself? Yeah. If Christ has forgiven you, trust Him. You are forgiven. I don't care what you have done. If Christ has forgiven you, you are forgiven by His grace. If you have a need today to pray, we have a place of prayer where people can come and they can kneel and they can pour out their hearts to God. You can give it to Him, no matter what your burden, whether it's forgiveness or some other need. Bring it to Him. Give it to the one who can actually do something about it. Someone who actually can bring change. Someone who actually has the power. While we struggle, He can do it. And He will. For by grace are you saved through faith. It's not your doing. It's the gift of God. Not because of works, so that we don't boast about it. Let's pray. Thank you, O God, for your love, mercy, and grace. Lord, you know all of our limitations. You know us way better than we know ourselves. And also, Lord, I know that there are needs that people have here in this place. Spiritual needs, physical needs, people need. I pray that you will inspire their faith to step out for you and come just as they are, without having any justifications, without bringing any gift, just themselves to you, with all the mess, with all the pain, with all the suffering, with all the hurt, with all the anger, that they'll bring it to you and give it to you. Oh God, I pray that you'll do your work. In Jesus' name, amen. Will you stand, please? We're going to sing an old, old, oldie, Amazing Grace. Most of us know it by heart. And if you want to come and pray, we invite you to do so.
Just as I am.
Today is a special day for you. It's the beginning of the rest of your life. And we go from here, and we make our lives what we choose to. Follow Jesus or not, it's your choice. You walk till you can, and God will walk with you in your training. May God be with you as you go your way. Let's join together in a final prayer. Thank you, O God, for our time together and your blessing to us. And I pray that we will take the message of Jesus to others and let others know about your grace. Bring the Chambliss family home to us safely. Thank you for them and their ministry. In Jesus' name, amen. Good night. No. See you later.